In section 8.2, we're going to be looking for confidence intervals for a population mean, only now the population standard deviation is unknown. There's only two objectives here, and that is to describe the properties of the student t distribution and then construct confidence intervals for a population mean when the population standard deviation is unknown. We are going to see a new distribution that looks an awful lot like the normal distribution, and it's called the student's t distribution. When we construct a confidence interval where we know the population standard deviation, we use this formula when the population standard deviation is known. The critical value is a z-score because that has a normal distribution. It's rare that we know the value of the population standard deviation while we estimate a value for mu. It's more common that we don't know it. If that happens, that we don't know the population standard deviation, we use a distribution that's called the student t distribution. The student t distribution has some similar characteristics to the normal distribution, and it's defined by the degrees of freedom. The formula we use for the degrees of freedom for a t-distribution is called n minus 1. Remember, with a normal distribution, it was defined by the parameters for the mean and the standard deviation. For a t-distribution, it's defined by the degrees of freedom. Here's a picture of a student t-distribution compared to a normal distribution. The solid black line right here is the standard normal distribution. The t-distribution changes, though, as the degrees of freedom change. This first graph right here, I'm guessing that's tan, this tan-colored dashed line, is a t-distribution with 1 degree of freedom. Notice it's the one that's most different from the normal. While it's symmetric and bell-shaped, it doesn't go up near as high, and the tails here are thicker, which means that the critical values are going to be different. The dotted blue line, or the dashed blue line, is a student t-distribution with 4 degrees of freedom, and the red one here is a t-distribution with 10 degrees of freedom. Notice that as our degrees of freedom change, that means that your sample size is increasing. As the degrees of freedom increase, this t-distribution looks more and more like a normal distribution. So as your sample size increases, the t-distribution approaches a normal distribution. The properties that we have with the normal distribution, we have the same properties with the t-distribution. The critical value, instead of being a z sub alpha over 2, is called a t sub alpha over 2, and how we find that t value is using inverse t on our calculator, and we need to put in our area, 1 minus alpha over 2, and then your degrees of freedom, which is n minus 1. Let's go to our calculators right fast. The inverse norm we found by hitting second vars, and it's number 3. Well, right below it, number 4, is the inverse t. If you have the older operating system, you may not have the inverse t on your calculator. If that's the case, you need to borrow a calculator from the math lab to find these critical values, or find an emulator on the internet that's free and download it on your computer while you're doing your homework. On a test, you would need to borrow a calculator from the math lab. So inverse t would be number 4. It's going to ask us for the area, the degrees of freedom, and then everything else is just like it was for the inverse norm. How we draw our picture to find our critical values is exactly like we did with the normal distribution. Our area in the middle is going to be 1 minus alpha. So if we had a 90% confidence interval, alpha would be 10%, and that would be 1 minus 10, and then this area over here would be 0.05. There is a table. If you go to your ebook, you can go to the appendix, and I think it's table A3. And it has a t-table. It has all these different t-scores for critical values. The way you would read the table is you'd look at the area in the right tail of the test, and these would be the areas. And then you'd go down for your degrees of freedom, and where the row and the column intersect, that's how you would get your critical value. It's easier just to use the inverse t. On this first example, we're told a simple random sample of size 10 is drawn from a normal population, n equals 10. Find the critical value for a 95% confidence interval. For a 95% confidence interval, alpha would be equal to what? 0.05. So alpha over 2 would be equal to 0.025. Our critical value can be found on the calculator using inverse t, 1 minus 0.05 divided by 2, with how many degrees of freedom? If our sample size is 10, our degrees of freedom would be 9. So I'm already here at the inverse t. My area is 1 minus 0.05 divided by 2. My degrees of freedom is 9. And we get 2.262 for our critical value. Notice our t-scores here for these critical values, they're all rounded to 3 decimal places. Z-scores, we usually round to 2 decimal places. T-scores are rounded to 3 decimal places. On your homework, you won't have to worry about that because it'll tell you how many decimal places to use. Some assumptions that we make whenever you're using a t-distribution is that you have a simple random sample, and either your sample size is sufficiently large or the population is approximately normal, just like it was for the central limit theorem. If we have raw data, we can check normality by looking at the normal quantile plot. We can also use the calculator to find a t-interval. It's right below the z-interval. We use the t-interval if your population standard deviation is unknown. We use the z-interval if our population standard deviation is known. In this first example, we're given a list of data. A food chemist analyzes the calorie content for a popular type of chocolate cookie. Following are the numbers of calories in a sample of 8 cookies. This is a small sample size, and we're not told if the population is normally distributed. We're just given the raw data. So the first thing we have to do is put the data into our calculators and then check to see if it's normally distributed. So let's do that. Let's put this list of data in list 1 on our calculator. Once you have the data in your list, go to your home screen, and now we need to see if it's normally distributed. We do that by hitting second y equals, and we're going to look at the normal quantile plot. Remember, the normal quantile plot is this last one underneath the type, so we highlight that last graph. Our data's in list 1. Everything else is fine. To get the best window, we hit zoom 9. And based on this normal quantile plot, would you say that your data are normally distributed or approximately normally distributed? Because they're normally distributed, we can proceed. We're going to use the calculator to find the confidence interval. So we go back to the home screen and we hit stat, tests, and we want the t interval. That's number 8. This time we actually have the raw data, so with data highlighted, you're going to tell your calculator what list your data's in. Leave the frequency alone because I don't know what it does. I always get the right answer if I leave it alone. Our confidence level, we were told, was 98%. And then we calculate the t-interval, and this is what we get. So based on this output, we would say that the mean calorie content for the cookies is going to be between 112 and 118. So we would say we're 98% sure that the average calorie content for the cookies is between 112 and 118 calories. To put the data in, you hit stat, tests, t interval is number 8, and then you highlight data. This is the input screen, and then when you go down to calculate, your confidence level needs to be 98%. That's got to be 0.98. And then when we go down to calculate, that's when we got the output. Example 2. A sample of 123 people aged 18 to 22 reported the number of hours they spent on the internet in an average week. The sample mean is 8.2 hours with a sample standard deviation. Because it's a sample standard deviation, I use S of 9.84 hours. Assume this is a simple random sample from a population of people aged 18 to 22 in the U.S. Construct a 95% confidence interval for mu, the population mean number of hours per week spent on the internet by people aged 18 to 22. We're going to use these summary statistics and our calculator to come up with the confidence interval. So we pull out our calculator. We hit stat, go over to tests. We want to do a t-interval, and the t-interval is number 8. Now we don't have raw data, we have summary statistics. So we highlight statistics. X bar was 8.2. You got to go down to X bar and hit 8.2. The sample standard deviation was 9.84. Our sample size was 123. Because our sample size is so large, we can assume normality. Our confidence level we were asked to find was a 95% level of confidence. So we change our confidence level to 0.95 and we hit calculate. And we get this for our output. So that means that our lower bound on our confidence interval is 6.44 and the upper bound would be 9.96. So we would say that we're 95% sure that people aged 18 to 22 spend between 6.44 and 9.96 hours per week on the internet. Personally, I think that is a low estimate. So you see how to do confidence intervals on the mean if you don't know the population standard deviation. We had to use the sample standard deviation. That's why I used a S here instead of a sigma. If they gave me the sigma, I could have used the Z interval, not the T interval, for confidence intervals on means. If the population standard deviation is known, we use the Z interval. If the population standard deviation is unknown, we use the T interval. And this wraps up section 8.2.